You're watching Over the Edge from Event Horizon with John Michael Godier.
Now, Doctor, tell us about the development of the labeled release experiment. What was the process to make it a reality?
Well, the results of the labeled release experiment have been published many, many times, but there's a story of how that experiment got to Mars, and that is what my book addresses. It's a very exciting story of how that instrument was developed. We had so many problems in getting it there, and we were early on told that every time we had a complaint about how something worked, we were told it's too late for instrument redesigns. And very rapidly, I figured out that if we were going to fix anything, it had to be with the sequence of events in which we manipulated the instrument. The instrument worked with a series of by pushing things around with helium and opening and closing valves. And that is how we were able to add the nutrient into the test cell and clean up the test cell. And as we developed problems with the instrument, we had to manipulate with heatings and cleaning things up and the sequence in which we cleaned things up and heated it in order to fix problems. And sometimes it was extremely complex. And I'd stay awake nights trying to figure out how to manipulate that instrument to make the experiment work. It was a very exciting time. And we thought we had solved all the problems. And then when we went to the test of the very first flight instrument, all three experiments totally failed. And I can remember Jim Martin coming in, who was head of the entire Viking project, and slamming his fist on the desk and saying, "We're going to throw biology off this mission." Well, somebody reminded him that he couldn't do that, that the Viking mission was funded as a biological mission. So he said, "Okay, we'll throw off the worst two experiments." And the problem was nobody could figure out which were the worst two. And from that point on, I must admit, the whole team worked 7 days a week, maybe 15 hours a day, trying to resolve all the problems. That for about a year and a half, until we finally had tests with further flight instruments. And just before the launch in our last flight instrument, we were able to show that the labeled release actually worked. It's a very exciting story as to how we got that instrument to work. And I must admit, when it landed on Mars, I didn't have a whole lot of faith that the instrument would work well. And it was a big surprise to me that it did. And it worked well in both landers and for all the tests, which was just fabulous, considering all the problems we had in getting it there.
Now, what's an example of a representative example of a problem that you had? As I recall, you had a helium valve problem at one point, right?
Well, one of the problems was the nutrient injection system. And I hate to kind of give that story away. It's a very interesting story. The first thing that happened in the first flight instrument is the whole system jammed and no nutrient was delivered. Well, we came up with an alternative method, and the alternative method ended up by dumping the entire contents of the nutrient into the test cell, and that was a big mess. How we resolved all that is a story that's told in my book.
Now, at the end, you guys made it through hard work and a lot of work. Now, how many people were involved on the team for these experiments?
Well, there was the biology flight team, which consisted of the experimenters of all the three experiments, a team leader, Chuck Klein, and several of the engineers from TRW that was responsible for building the instrument. But to get it there was a much, much larger team. I can't even tell you how many engineers were involved at TRW where the instrument was being built. And when all the crisis happened, we got personnel from Martin Marietta and from NASA headquarters that joined everybody, and we had a very large team trying to get that instrument to work. After all the crises that happened, we'd have meetings every single morning of these teams and tried to try to understand exactly what we had to accomplish by what time in order to meet the deadline of shipping the instrument to the Cape. But there were hundreds of people involved in it.
Now, when it was in the cruise phase, just on its way to Mars, what did you have to do to keep the experiment? I mean, did you basically ignore it until it arrives, or what, did you actively have to?
Oh, no, indeed. We had what we call the test standards module, which was an instrument that was designed for repeated use. And what we did during that period of time is we used the instrument to try and develop a library of responses. And, for example, we collected soils that were sterile soils. And that's a hard thing to do, by the way. We did find some actual sterile soils from terrestrial soils. One was the island of Surtsey, which in, I believe it was 1969, there was a volcanic eruption in the ocean just outside of Greenland, and it built up until it was above the ocean level. And as it cooled, samples were collected by Richard Young, who was from NASA headquarters, a microbiologist from NASA headquarters, and they were collected under sterile conditions and distributed to each of the three experiments. It was important to see that if you really had a sterile soil, that you didn't get a positive response.
Right.
And we also tested moon samples, which was another sterile soil, so that we could show that when you really had a sterile soil, you did not get a positive response. The response was negative. That was important. We also tested many, many soils from Antarctica, where we knew that we would have low microbial levels within the soil, and we were trying to get a library of responses from such soils that might be helpful in interpreting Mars data. So we were not idle during the time that the mission was en route to Mars. We were very busy collecting data that would help us interpret whatever we found on Mars.
What was the atmosphere among the team like as the mission was landing? In other words, the will it make it moment, you know, as Viking enters the Martian atmosphere. What is that like?
Oh, boy, that was an exciting time. You know, that we had only had one other spacecraft that had ever gone into orbit around Mars. That was Mariner 9. And here we had the Viking now that went into orbit around Mars and started sending pictures back. And walls were just covered with photographs from Mars as they created mosaics and pasted them all together, looking for a landing site, which took much longer than was anticipated. And the time was a very exciting time for everybody waiting for that landing. And everybody, of course, was on pins and needles that we would get that spacecraft down space safely. In fact, the night that it landed, everybody stayed up all night long. It was released from the orbiter around midnight, and it took 5 hours to get to the surface. And as it approached, they showed a column of numbers. They flashed the numbers, which was the altitude above the surface, and it came in. It looked to me like it came in so fast. The numbers were like 1,300 feet, 650 feet, 50 feet, silence. And I just stood there with I was sick in the pit of my stomach. It seemed to me like it had just come in way too fast. It must have crashed. And while I'm standing there in stunned silence, all of a sudden they said, "We have touchdown," over the loudspeaker, and everybody was quiet for about a millisecond, and then cheers erupted from all over the building. It was an extremely exciting time. And this is about 5 o'clock in the morning, and the cheers were followed immediately by champagne at 5 o'clock in the morning. And everybody gathered around as the first photographs of the surface of Mars were flashed onto the screen. Very exciting time.
Now, the second landing, I don't remember how much later that was. Was there anything noteworthy about that? I mean,
well, in the biology team room, it was almost too much to ask that we would have two successful landings. I remember Jerry Soffen and Gentry Lee, who was the project scientist on Viking, and Gentry Lee, who was from JPL, And the two of them jumped up and down and laughed and joked when the landing was successful, and they ended up on the floor. They were just so excited, tears rolling down their cheeks. And I actually got a picture of that. It's in my book.
Now, you also collected the signatures from the team as well, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I did. Everybody thought I was crazy. The post office issued first day issues of envelopes, and I collected them, and I went around and got signatures of every member of the biology team. That's reproduced in my book. Everybody laughed at me for doing it, and all my answer was, well, you can do it too if you want to, but nobody else did.
A very unique archival thing from this mission.
Yes. Yes, indeed. And those are treasured envelopes, and all of my data and will be donated to Johns Hopkins on my passing, and including those envelopes. Those are treasured, and I certainly want them preserved forever.
The moment of the detection, the positive detection, this would be the moment in human history where we realize that life on Earth is not alone, potentially speaking. What did that feel like?
Well, the moment when we got that positive response was an extremely exciting moment, and one of that happened around 7:30 on July 30th at 7:30 at night, and we immediately called the rest of the biology team in to discover this. The problem was that there was going to be a press conference the next morning, and we were going to have to report these data. But the thing of it is we hadn't yet done the control. So exciting as it was to have a positive response, you had to be very careful because the experiment wasn't complete. So everything had to be put in perspective that we had to wait for the control to see, to confirm that was a positive response. Well, it was a positive response regardless of the control, but whether or not it was a biological or a chemical response depended on what we got from the heat-sterilized control. So exciting as it was, we had to sit on it for a little bit.
That was a bit of material that went over the edge. A bonus clip from a full episode of Event Horizon. New episodes every Thursday, so do be sure to hit subscribe. The full episode should be on your screen right about now.